If ever we needed a vivid example of why good data is important, a new report from the Pan-Canadian Health Data Strategy Expert Advisory Group has just provided that. It lays out how Canada's efforts to deal with COVID-19 faced real data gaps that they said severely limited our response to this pandemic. With us now to explain, the chair of that advisory group, Dr. Vikek Goel, professor of the Dalla, Lana School of Public Health at the University of Toronto, but only for a little longer. He's about to become the new president of the University of Waterloo, for which we congratulate you, and we are delighted to welcome you back to TVO. How are you doing?
Great. Thank you for having me back on the show.
Not at all. Why don't we just start with what that committee is that you chair, the Canadian Health Data Strategy Expert Advisory Group. What is that?
So just going back a year ago, the first ministers had an agreement called the Safe Restart Agreement, which was quite ambitious at the time, hoping that would get the society going last summer. Within that agreement, there was a component that made a commitment about improving the quality of data that we had on COVID. And those were some immediate actions in terms of case-based data and race and ethnicity data. But there was also a commitment amongst everyone involved, the first ministers and the prime minister, that we should not get ourselves in this situation again, where we don't have good, timely data in the situation of a health emergency like we found ourselves in. And so this longer-term health data strategy work that I'm chairing an expert group on really rose out of that, that let's learn from the lessons of the pandemic and try to ensure that we can build some information and data systems that ensures that Canada doesn't fall into the same situation again.
What was the biggest problem our decision makers had to face given the lack of excellent data that you would want to have?
Yeah, so there's not just, unfortunately, one big problem, but I can just give you a few examples. I cited, for example, race and ethnicity data. You know, we don't have good race and ethnicity data on our cases, on who's in hospital, who's in ICU. And so that means we're not really able to tell who's being affected the most. It's taken quite a bit of work and quite a bit of time linking together census data with case data, using what's called ecological studies to actually build those profiles. And 6 months, a year into the pandemic, we really started to understand where the hotspots were. So for that's an example of where if we'd had better data right off the bat, we could have really made those decisions about where to target interventions faster. Another example is with the occupation and site of outbreaks. So people who are getting the disease, where are the transmissions happening? If we had better data around that, we could have made much more finely tuned decisions about where to impose shutdowns or lockdowns and not had to do the blanket measures that we've had. I'll just give one final example because we're in the middle of it right now. In terms of the vaccine rollout, we all can see the many systems from the basic things like booking the appointments, but you know, keeping track of who's had the vaccine. And so the provinces and the federal government are working on how do we develop the certifications of immunization that we'll all be able to carry as we travel abroad. The federal government needs to have access to the data that sits in the provincial systems in order to do that. We also need that vaccination data to get merged with testing data and healthcare utilization data to actually track how well the vaccines are working in our communities. And we have some very unique questions in Canada because of our different strategies with respect to dose intervals and the mix of vaccines. So we can't just rely on the evidence coming from other countries. We need to be generating that evidence in real time in Canada.
Now, the way you've described it, it sounds as if it would be quite useful, even urgent, to have this information. Why do you suppose we weren't collecting it from the beginning?
So this is where our expert group started its work. And unfortunately, this is not a new issue. And we have had challenges with health data in Canada. And the first thing we did was we actually looked at reports going back 60 years. And many of the findings that we describe in our first report have been described in previous reports. In fact, we have quotations from a report by Martin Wilk, chief statistician in 1991, and a quotation from David Naylor's inquiry into SARS in 2003. And if you read those quotations without knowing when they were written, you'd think they're describing health data in Canada today. The challenges are, again, multiple. I'll start with probably the most fundamental, and it is that our health system is not a system. It's a distribution across the provinces and territories. And within each province and territory, particularly in Ontario, we have regions, we have hospitals, we have public health units, we have multiple providers in primary care and many other places. They all have different information technology. They all have different systems. And so none of these things actually talk to each other very well. So this is a longstanding issue. And beyond sort of the technical aspects, we have significant policy issues in the sense that data sharing is really set up to work in the environment of paper medical records. So we have health information custodians that you go to check out certain pieces of data, which is what I used to do when I was a medical student and I had to go get a chart in the basement of the hospital from the medical records technician, right? And so, but in a digital age, this concept of a health information custodian doesn't make as much sense. And so we have to modernize a lot of our policy frameworks as well as our technical systems.
Well, I think your committee is even stronger on this than you just suggested because, well, here's the quote, there's a culture of avoidance, it's been said, around collecting and sharing health data. And a problem you've just described goes back 30 years. Why would there be this culture of avoidance?
Yeah, so there's many aspects of that. One, just in terms of the privacy, health privacy legislation, the health information custodians really are given no incentive or no motivation to share, but they are likely to face severe consequences if there's a privacy breach. So if the data is inadvertently exposed by someone they provide it to, they're the one that is held responsible. So if you're a hospital administrator and you're asked to turn over some genomic data on COVID-19, you have no benefit from that, but you bear all the risks. And so that's one of the things in terms of modernizing the framework that's necessary. The other issue is that perhaps, and you know, we've seen evidence of this, those individuals may feel that this data, once it's collated and assembled, could lead to results that might be embarrassing for them. I think that's less the case today than it might have been 15 or 20 years ago, because people are used to measurement, metrics, and being judged. But you know, certainly we believe that there are sometimes individual providers and organizations that may be reluctant to share data if it's going to reveal things that may be consequential for them.
Okay, I totally get the second one, so let me follow up on the first part. I presume you agree that protecting the privacy of the people that you are looking into is a hugely important thing, and that we all ought to be concerned about that, yes?
Yes.
Okay, so can you understand then the concerns around very private personal health information squeaking out?
Yeah, absolutely. And so we're not talking about putting the data on the internet and making it available for everyone. We have to look at approaches that protect the privacy of the individuals, but enable the analysis that Canadians want to see being done happening. So the example I just gave of looking at vaccine evaluation, you can do that by bringing data sets together in a de-identified manner. You can do it by doing it in secure places like the Institute for Clinical Evaluative Sciences. It doesn't mean that you have to make all of the data exposed, but you have to enable the sharing and bringing together of the data in a privacy-protecting manner.
Understood. I always like to find out who's doing this better than we are. So as you look around the world, are there other jurisdictions that sort of have this nailed in the way you'd like to see and that we ought to be copying?
Well, there's a number of jurisdictions that do have this going well. And I'll also note there are Canadian jurisdictions that are doing it well. Alberta is a good example. Because they've moved to a model of a single health authority, their health system and public health data are coming together much more seamlessly than in some of the other provinces and territories. But globally, certainly the United Kingdom, England in particular, have been investing in these sorts of approaches for some time. and they were much better served. So one of the reasons why we've seen the variants emerging in the United Kingdom first is because they've got great systems for bringing together the data from the healthcare system, from public health, and the genomic system, the research testing capacities all together in secure ways that I just described. And so they picked up the first one, which is now known as Alpha. And then the Delta variant, which started in India, but it really we've been watching grow in the United Kingdom, is because they have both large amounts of testing going on, but also the sharing of the data and bringing it together with other sources, such as in the health system. So they're able to calculate how transmissible it is. They're able to predict whether the mortality rate is higher much more quickly than we're able to do here in Canada or in many other parts of the world.
I see. Given that you're an educator, I'm going to presume that you wish our population in general was just a lot more data slash data, however you pronounce it, literate than we currently are. And I wonder what you think, what kinds of problems arise in a population when the population really isn't very data literate to begin with?
So I absolutely agree that data literacy is important for, in this conversation, really for two reasons. One is we need people to understand what the value of that data is, how it can be used to improve their own lives, their own health care, but also that of their family and friends. And so that the sharing of data, as we just described, is going to benefit them and their community. But second, basic data literacy is important, and we've seen it throughout the pandemic. When people are talking about the effectiveness of vaccines, how are those rates calculated? Even something as basic as how many people are vaccinated, we need to know the difference between the denominator that's being used. Is it the entire population? Is it adults? Is it those that are eligible? The rates that you get are very different. And people get confused because they say one place says it's 75% have had it, another place says it's 65%. Well, if you don't understand how those rates are being calculated, what the sources of data are, then you're going to get confused about it. So that is an example of data literacy that would help people in better understanding what's happening and making more informed decisions about which vaccine is safe for them, which vaccine is going to be effective.
You know, in a weird kind of way, the pandemic has provided an opportunity for Canadians to become just so much more aware of issues such as this. I mean, we're all a bunch of would-be epidemiologists nowadays.
Yeah.
Do you think there's an opening here because of the pandemic for people to really get on top of this in a way they weren't in the past?
Absolutely. And to be honest, this is one of the things I'm really looking forward to with my new role at Waterloo, is to think about what's that general level of data literacy that every graduate should have, regardless of what discipline they're in. And I'll also note, this was not just an issue because of the pandemic, right? We already were facing the need for greater data literacy throughout society. You know, big data is driving so many parts of our economy and society. Every time we have an interaction with someone online, we're generating more data. So we need to understand what that data is, how it's getting used, and how we can take advantage of it in our own lives.
All right. In which case, I gather you would love to create a national system which would take an approach to collecting and sharing health data that would be, you know, less fussed over jurisdictional boundaries, like in this province it's this way, in that province it's that way, in that territory it's yet another way. You'd like to do something genuinely national. Is that fair to say?
Well, the language we use for our vision is we actually call it ecosystem. So one of the great things now with the technologies and systems that are available now, we don't have to have a big single Canadian box of data. We can have it distributed across the country and provinces and territories. What we need are standards for how it's collected, how it's coded, so it's comparable across the provinces and territories. We need the policy frameworks that allow for the connections and the sharing to be made so that people can bring the data together when it's necessary. So in Canada, I think we can find something that would work within our uniquely Canadian structure, respect the constitutional authorities of the provinces and territories, but also bring data together in a way that enables the analyses that Canadians deserve to happen. And we have examples of that already happening. There's something known as the Drug Safety Evaluation Network, which works across the provinces and territories. The data stay in each province and territory within their jurisdictional boundaries, but there's common standards for how the analyses get done, how the data is structured, so that when it comes together, you can pull all the results together and you can create a Canadian picture.
Has Quebec agreed to participate in this?
So that's one of the great constitutional questions. Quebec will not, I think, be participating in a single national system. And so the solution we have to find has to be the kind of ecosystem that I just described. And the example I use is, after the Creever inquiry into tainted blood, we had the creation of Canadian Blood Services that operates in every province and territory except Quebec, and Héma-Québec in Quebec. But they work across common standards and approaches. And so every Canadian gets an equivalent level of service there in terms of blood banking. And I think we can work towards a model that will allow respect for provinces and territories, but ensure that we have common standards across the country.
I'm going to throw a real high, tight fastball on you right now. And that is, I mean, you're a medical guy. You're an education guy. You're not a politician. And yet you can never get away from the politics in the work that you do. Isn't that right?
Yeah, that's right.
And how annoying is that to you?
Well, one of the things that we've said quite a bit is that the issues that we're facing are not data issues. They're not data science issues. They're not computer science. They are these political, policy, legal issues. And we just talked about data literacy. They're really about working with the public and developing the social license. And, I'm medical, but I'm a public health physician, and we always work with these social and political issues. People have said public health is politics.
Ain't that the truth? Let me just, in our last minute here, ask you one last question about your next mission in life. As we said off the top, you're going to the University of Waterloo to become the president later this week. What's your chief mission going to be there?
Well, it is going to be helping Waterloo and its region, as well as our entire country, come out of this period of time. I think we have an exciting period to look forward to with the recovery from the pandemic. I think certainly the indicators are there will be a relatively quick economic recovery, but we have a lot of rebuilding to do, and we have to ensure we don't wind up in the same situation again. And one of the things we have to look at is repatriating the manufacturing of our critical supplies like vaccines, medical equipment. And Waterloo, as a manufacturing center for many decades, is uniquely poised to help work on that with for the rest of Canada.
That has surely been one of the big lessons in the last 15 months, to be sure. Dr. Goel, it's really good of you to join us on TVO tonight. Good luck with your next mission, and thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.